morning. IBPC members, our seniors, IBPC past presidents, guests, ladies and gentlemen. I, on behalf of the Administrative Board of the Indian Business and Professional Council, welcome you all to this business breakfast meeting today morning with great pleasure. Today, our topic is Entrepreneurship Simplified with one of the most iconic business leaders in the Indian ID spectrum, Sri Ashok Soota. He's going to talk about information technology, entrepreneurship, and startups, which are all the cutting edge subjects of the 21st century. When this is blended with 35 years of vast experience in the IT sector alone, we have a legend from the best of the both worlds. In fact, three worlds together. We also have a young and dynamic entrepreneur, Mr. Monis Rahman, a Stanford graduate who will also give a short presentation today on Bitcoin 101. To begin our session, I'd like to welcome our president, Advocate Mrs. Bindu Suresh Chettur, to do the presidential address.
Honorable speakers, my dear fellow members of Indian Business and Professional Council, guests, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning, namaskar, assalamu alaikum. On behalf of the Administrative Board of Indian Business and Professional Council, I welcome you all today for this very unique session, and I'm so privileged and honored to have Mr. Ashok Soota, the co-founder. He is presently the executive chairman and also the co-founder of the Happiest Mind Technologies. He has 35 years of vast experience in the IT industry, and he is also the past president of Wipro Technology, Wipro Infotech, and co-founder of Mindtree IT consulting company. He was the president of the Confederation of Indian Industries, another feather on his cap, and the president of Manufacturers Association of Information Technology. Indeed, it's a unique opportunity for all of us to listen to such a great visionary leader from business with such vast experience and wisdom in the IT sector, and somebody who has an understanding of the business ecosystem. India is blessed with the world's best IT brains, and I can say that Mr. Ashok Soota is one of the gem among them. He is also widely recognized, and he has published so many books, and he will be sharing his wisdom today, Entrepreneurship Simplified from Idea to IPO. When I learned about Mr. Ashok Soota, the most inspiring factor which I noticed was that at the age of 68, when everybody of us are thinking of retiring, he started a firm of his own, and he brought it to $62 million enterprise in 5 years. Welcome you for this inspiring session. Today we are also having another very young inspiring speaker, Mr. Monis Rahman, and he's the head of research at Monis, a Stanford University blockchain startup. I welcome you as well. He is going to share his experience as well. So looking forward for a very inspiring, knowledgeable, and very interactive unique session here. I'm deeply honored, as I told, to welcome both of them. Looking forward for a beautiful, very great day for all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Madam President. Now I'd like to invite Mr. Nimish Vakwana, Administrative Board member, to give a detailed presentation and introduction about our speaker.
Good morning, speakers, guests, and members. It's my honor to introduce today's our speaker, Mr. Ashok Soota, who took out time from his busy schedule to enlighten IBPC members. And here I would like to take this opportunity to thank Sharjah International Book Fair also. He's addressing Sharjah International Book Fair, and they were kind enough to give the slot of Mr. Ashok Soota for IBPC members. Ashok Soota, Executive Chairman, Happiest Mind, a next generation IT services company, is widely recognized as one of the pioneering leaders of the Indian IT industry. Prior to founding Happiest Mind, Ashok led the growth of Wipro's IT business. Subsequently, he was founding chairman and MD of Mindtree and led it through a very successful IPO. He was president of Confederation of Indian industry, CII, India's largest industry association, and also president of Manufacturers Association of Information Technology. For his contribution to India's IT industry, he has been recognized twice as IT Man of the Year, also as Electronics Man of the Year, and recognized at INCOM 2013 Kolkata as one of the 12 gems who helped to build Indian IT industry. As you know, his topic is Entrepreneurship Simplified. He has written a book along with S.R. Gopalan, and this book will be available outside once he will leave, and it's a very limited books are there, so you can collect it while Mr. Soota is leaving around, say, 9:45 to 9:50. I would like to share a couple of quotes here on this book by Anand Mahindra, a must-read for every would-be entrepreneur. Soota and Gopalan chart the journey from the idea to IPO with remarkable clarity, full of valuable insights and an absolute pleasure to read. And Aziz Premji, who wrote on this book, extremely readable book, both your complementary perspectives and experiences add tremendous value to the book. While the book is useful for the entrepreneurs, several chapters also make interesting reading for established business. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Mr. Soota.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is a pleasure to be here, and I must say that I'm really impressed by the gathering you have here at the Indian Business IBPC, is that correct? Wonderful gathering. Last time I've spoken in Dubai, I was reminded of it from my old friend from CII. It was 2003. And here I've had the pleasure of meeting a lot of old friends, which is always the nice thing about coming back to Dubai. There are people from, which go way back beyond my IT days, so including somebody who was there in my early days in the Shriram Group, and of course many others I've met in the course of my IT career. So it really is a pleasure to be here. I need to be clear in a subject like this, what I'd like to address with a group which is as varied. Many of you have been established businesses. There are lots of young entrepreneurs or people who are involved in helping entrepreneurs, private equity. You've got a technologist who's going to speak to you. I'm not sure whether technologist is the right word because you have your own startup. So I just want to get a feel of what stage you're at your things. How many of you, for example, would be interested in hearing about, say, startup or scale-up strategies versus how many of you would be interested in funding your enterprises? If I can just get a feel of that, I'll focus a little bit more because the theme of Entrepreneurship Simplified is obviously going all the way from idea generation to IPO, and I'd like to just focus on what may be on people's minds. So who do you think, I mean, just to get a show of hands, how many of you are more keen on understanding startup and scale-up strategies versus maybe a show of hands, and I'll ask for how many are interested in funding. And obviously Dubai is a great market for funding. So startup and scale-up strategies, quite a few. Okay, a very large majority, I would imagine. Maybe I might, and this is not mutually exclusive, you can put your hand up both times. So how many of you are interested in funding related areas? Okay, so it's a smaller group. Let me then focus on much more on the strategic aspect. And you know, strategy in today's day and age has to begin with technology. Not technology for the sake of what technology can do, but the way it is impacting and changing business models. And just to give you a feel of how that change is taking place, you know, all of us are today, we take the internet obviously for granted. We're all wedded to our phones, the internet, social media, and so on. Just look at the internet. It is really a little over 15 years old, moving all the way in this period from the internet 1.0, which is a read-only web, today to the 5.0. So it's been through so many versions, if you will, of the internet, which is today a semantic web where you can communicate, get data in real time, and so many other things. While this was evolving, it made so many new businesses possible, which could not even have been conceived of without all those changes. Today, when you look at it, there are at least, I would imagine, a dozen plus technologies which are going through similar evolutions. So in the days that we began Happiest Minds, it was largely about SMAC, which is social, mobile, analytics, and cloud. Unified communications is something we added on. But many, many more technologies keep coming up. And each of these then helps to transform and helps you to create new businesses. So it could include today, for example, 3D manufacturing. It includes clearly AI and cognitive computing, which is causing every one of these, let me tell you, is both an opportunity and in some cases a threat to incumbents in any case. There's blockchain, which you're going to hear about today. Began with something called bitcoins and digital currency, but today has multiple new applications. There's nanotechnologies which are coming and making many other industries possible, including 3D manufacturing, which is going to have a huge impact, I would say, on the real estate business even here in Dubai. So you can just see how things come together. And then there are a whole host of what I'll call as automation-related businesses. They've had the IT industries responsible for the creation and evolution of these. But today it's, of course, coming back like a, you could say, a Frankenstein, which is also biting our own industry because it's destroying a lot of jobs, but creating a few higher value-added jobs. You know, in our business, we had testing, certainly has gone through a huge amount of automation and DevOps, and thereby eaten up about 30% of the ongoing number of jobs in that business. Then the business process outsourcing got highly automated. And now, of course, you got a huge wave of robotic process automation. But again, as I said, it's not the technologies alone. I mean, we as a company in the IT industry help our customers to adopt these latest technologies. You as people in business use all of these to be able to get into newer, differentiated businesses that where you deploy those technologies. Now, let me start with, in terms of strategies, how you would, in the first instance, just generate your idea. And I'm sure, although many of you have already had very successful businesses, but the fact of the matter is that those businesses, even businesses which have been very stable for so many years, are suddenly undergoing major change. And the change then is both the opportunity and, as I said, a threat if you don't get onto it. And in this context, the first thing that you need to do in terms of idea generation is odds are that your business today is going to be modified, or your new idea altogether is going to be a digital platform or a digital business. And therefore, you begin with a few basic fundamentals. You have to begin with a customer pain point, a customer problem. It should be scalable. You know, I think too many people start businesses which just don't have the opportunity to scale. And then they spend a large part of their lives struggling to be able to grow those, never able to pay themselves a decent salary. Life becomes a drudge and a bore. To my mind, whatever you set out to do should never impede or come in the way of creating a business where you can say, I've lived my life to the fullest, you have a happy life. And I think that, to my mind, is an equally important part of getting into business. Whereas people get driven by the thought that they're going to go out and then just generate money. But I think success and happiness go hand in hand. There's another question that comes in when you ask yourself about a new business. Do I want to be a first mover or an early follower? The logical first reaction is, hey, I want to be the first to do something in the world, and or in my region or wherever it is. But you know, creating markets, and if you are the first mover, creating markets takes a lot of money. A lot of people don't realize that creating your product or service is not even 1/10 of the total cost of going into business to create a healthy, viable business. And to that extent, if you get into something which is being built, market needs have been identified, markets are growing, but you come in with a differentiated model, it helps. And just to give you an idea, Microsoft was not the first operating system. Google was not the first search engine. Facebook was not the first social media platform. And even Apple, for all its influence in terms of being a great innovator, was certainly not the first smartphone. So in all of these, people came in and improved upon ideas which existed and then helped to scale them and define the markets. There is a little approach where I think you can apply and which we in the book describe as a kaleidoscope model for generating your ideas. And I'm sure most of you are familiar with, but can I get a show of hands on how many of you know or are willing to volunteer to say what is a kaleidoscope? I'm sure you've all played with a kaleidoscope as a kid. I spoke yesterday at the Sharjah Book Fair, and I was amazed that dozens of hands went up, and they were really quite rare. I'm sure you have. I think people are just being a little diffident, and you have played with a kaleidoscope. Not a single person who's, there you are. Now suddenly you can find there are lots and lots of people. And do you mind telling everybody what is a kaleidoscope, the gentleman? Yeah, but how does it happen? What exactly is it? It does help you to identify. Sure. So perfect. So let's give you a hand for at least describing that correctly. And so it's nothing but that old tube. I'm sure you've all played with it as kids. Unless these things went out of fashion in the last 20 years, but I certainly know all the kids I've known seem to have had access to one. It's literally a little tube, bits and pieces of glasses. As you rotate it, you get a new pattern. So why am I talking of a kaleidoscope in context of new businesses? And that is that you ask yourself a series of questions, and each of those questions may throw up a new business model. Now all of us, and just to illustrate that, all of us at some stage or the other have rented a car, hired a vehicle for something or the other, and so on. So one of the oldest services which has existed. Supposing you started with that and you asked yourself a question of saying, how do I change the asset ownership in my business? And maybe can I avoid owning any of the assets? How do I convert my fixed costs into variable costs? How do I use the latest technology to provide connectivity using satellites and other means so that the service becomes more flexible? How do I ensure the most optimal usage of whatever assets, whether owned by me or somebody else? And lo and behold, you take a very old traditional service and you have an Uber. It's just an answer to each of these questions. Largest car company in the world, car rental company if you will, doesn't own a single vehicle itself. Doesn't have any of the drivers on its roll, so it's all a variable cost. You can't get better utilization of your assets because now the individual is taking sure that they're utilizing the asset as well. So no amount of monitoring, no head office, MISs to make sure that your assets are being well utilized. And look at the flexibility it provides. If I had to come out here for a day in Dubai, I'm lucky that you have actually offered to pick me up, but otherwise I'd rent a car for the day. And here you don't need to do it anymore. Uber's available at a call. So therefore, the benefit to the consumer is also huge in terms of variable costs. So you can see how this model could be applied to half a dozen different businesses by asking yourself a series of questions. The next step, I think, before you start and implement any of your ideas, I think is really to validate that idea. And you know, I wouldn't recommend that we do very expensive market research. I wouldn't go to the opposite extreme of Steve Jobs, who was a genius, who said he never believed in market research because he said the consumer doesn't know what she wants. So he decided and anticipated and was able to provide the latest. But you do need to validate your ideas. I think the best way of validating your idea, in my view, is to share it, discuss it, socialize it, dream, breathe, think that idea for at least 4 to 6 months. And the idea will keep evolving. I do believe that you should also go to VCs. A lot of people hesitate to do that in their businesses. I know there's a gentleman from private equity here who will be happy to hear that recommendation because I think they add value to your business. They're a part of an ecosystem which has been there, done that. They know what is more likely to succeed. They don't just take your idea and say, we'll fund it. They'll help you to modify and adapt the idea. So I think these are some of the things that you need to be able to do. I think you need to also put your idea through a defensibility test. Now, When we talk of defensibility here, it's not that it'll remain static at all times. That changes with market needs, market environment, the stage at which you're entering a given market. And I'll just give you two examples here. One where I think they've had very good defensibility and the other where the defensibility has been very poor. Let's take the e-commerce industry. In many other parts of the world, it's an industry which is dominated by Amazon. But in India, maybe 8-9 years ago when e-commerce began opening out, obviously Amazon was not there. So it looked like a wonderful opportunity for everybody to be able to get into that space. The net effect is that you had a dozen large e-commerce players, very heavily funded. You know, they were able to raise literally billions of dollars of funds. And yet when Amazon came in, see what's happened. Everybody went either collapsed or got acquired or went through a down round. So even Flipkart, which is, you might say, almost the sole survivor of the domestic players, has lost heavily in terms of the fact that it went through two down rounds before it's now begun to stabilize itself. Now, all of this is not literally only the basic defensibility in the context of having to deal and compete with a giant. But of course, there were strategic errors. In my view, the biggest strategic error was that they relied heavily on price. The e-commerce business was going to take off anyway. But the moment you say that we are going to price your business or your service in a way that is so low that that becomes your main driver to attract business, and then a giant like Amazon comes in with far deeper pockets, and they then underprice you, you've got no margins to play with, no margins to build a healthy business. So the main thing about this is you've got to see your path to profitability. And that path must be achieved very early in the game. Otherwise, you're going to run out of cash, you're going to end into situations of not being able to raise the next round, and or you'll end up doing what the others have done in terms of down rounds. You might say, when does pricing become a strategy? In my belief, pricing is only a logical strategy when your costs are lower than your competition. It's unlikely that as a newcomer that your costs would be lower than large players in the market, in which case you should never make price the strategy. If you're a Reliance and you know that you're going to build scale in a way that your costs are going to be lower and you're targeting for those lower costs, then of course you can do that, but everybody is not a Reliance and everybody doesn't have an industry there sitting around like a duck waiting to be shot. And therefore, if your costs are lower, by all means offer that benefit to your customer. I'd say the Indian IT industry did that in all of our early years when we brought the work back offshore. It's not that otherwise why were our costs? They wouldn't have been lower, but we were able to offer skills which could execute complex projects from India and execute them all over the world. And the MNCs who dominated the market didn't realize what we were doing until we became a $20 billion industry. By then it was too late, and we've now built it into a $150 billion industry, but cost is no longer the driver. You've also got to be clear, this will be, because then that benefit was so large that today offshore has become the de facto standard. And everybody, including IBM, has 100,000 people in India. Accenture has 100,000 people in India. So that's become a part of the global delivery model. I was giving you another example of defensibility, which I think has worked exceedingly well. Here we had the story of Amazon and the other e-commerce players. Take something like coffee, and all of you have stepped into a Starbucks somewhere or the other. Well before Starbucks came into India, we had Cafe Coffee Day. We had another player called Barista, but Cafe Coffee Day went well ahead of them. What Cafe Coffee Day did was to get themselves into so many multiple price points and types of outlets, which Starbucks would never have targeted anywhere else in the world. So they had outlets in every office, they had outlets in schools and colleges, and of course they had the typical internet-enabled lounges in different parts of the country. That network of maybe upwards of 10,000 outlets is something that Starbucks, having entered into India, will never be able to replicate. They'll never get to those price points. They'll never get the penetration that these guys have got. And they'd have to change their business model to say that we're into that business. They probably wouldn't do it for one country. So therefore, I think even for the next 15 years, I don't see Starbucks impacting Cafe Coffee Day. If anything, it just increases the culture of consumption, introduces a new set of users where Cafe Coffee Day will also get its share of the market. So I've covered a few things in terms of idea generation. I have touched on very briefly strategies to compete against larger players. I won't get into these in any depth, but again, they're detailed in the book for those of you who are interested. But there are three of them which I could very briefly tell you about. One is judo strategy. It's something which was defined in the first instance by C.K. Prahlad and Gary Hamel in an article in the Harvard Business Review. And since then, of course, multiple people have written whole books on judo strategy. But the essence of judo strategy is that you use the strength of the opponent to make it a weakness, or you change the rules of the game. And David and Goliath is a very good example of that. You know, David completely changed the rules of the game by coming in with his catapult and stone against a person who everybody thought he had no chance against. Another strategy or a thought is something which I think we have defined for ourselves in this. Maybe somebody will later on go and write a more learned book about it, and that's called Tai Chi thinking. The idea really came to me because we had engaged, as a part of our wellness initiatives, a leading group for Tai Chi in Happiest Minds. I noticed that you're involved in wellness, so this could be. We have yoga and Tai Chi and multiple other things which we do for our people. And you know, when they came in to sell their services, they had said, "Do you mind if we do a small little demo?" It's really not the essence of what they were doing, but it was very dramatic. So they had this girl there who's quite frail, nothing more than about 5 feet, 3 or 4. And they said, "Look, can we invite one of the persons in the team in the room, sit it there, and see if he can push her? And pick your biggest, toughest looking guy." So this guy came, and if it hadn't been our own person, I would have said this was a trick. And he came up and he tried his level best till he was perspiring, and he couldn't budge her an inch. And then he said, "Look, do you mind if she pushes you?" He said, "No, go ahead." And I think the person who actually runs this academy called CIFA Wellness, he decided to strategically position himself behind this guy, because then, with literally what looked like nothing more than a flick of her finger, she had this guy staggering back. And, you know, so we asked, "So what's the secret of this?" I don't think we are all going to learn it by having Tai Chi being taught in our offices. But essentially it was saying you have to be firm where you need to be firm and flexible where you can be flexible. So you're firm at the root and the core and flexible where you need to be. So you absorb all that and let that therefore impact the other party. I can give you an example of where we were able to use that technique. We are a young company. Wherever we go, we find that there are 10 other incumbents, or at least 5 or 6 of the largest incumbents. We went to one of the largest retailers in the US, and they had to put up something for an Apple show where they had to create a product which they were running against time. And they asked us, "Do you think you can do it?" And we've got these 4 other guys, but if, you know, by the time they assemble a team, we think we'll be losing half the time. So we said, "Okay, we'll do it. And however, but we're going to charge you a premium price." They say, "Hey, but you're a young company and you should need the business." But we said, "Look, you're not going to compromise on the quality of the skills you're expecting. And we're going to agree to do it in a time. We'll take a penalty if you don't, if you're not ready on time for your show." So we agreed with that as a strategy. And then they also, I mean, the stakes for them were so high, it didn't matter if they paid us a little bit more. For us, it's important, which is why I say you should not be compromising on price. They would take 10% from us and eat up, say, maybe 30% of our margin. We did this, we delivered the product on time, it won an award at the show, the company went on to become our largest customer. So this could be, so that's the second one, and the third, of course, is guerrilla warfare. I gave you the example of the Indian IT industry, where you begin and make a hit attack in one area. The larger player says, I'm not going to change my business model because of this. But before you know it, you move from segment to segment, and then you've covered the entire industry. I should be a little mindful on time, because I do want to keep some time for questions. I actually like to keep half of the time, because then at least you're relating what you're saying to what's on people's minds and so on. So if somebody can tell me how we're doing, and if we have 15, 20 minutes left of my time, then I'll just turn it over for questions from the audience. Is that okay? So if I have a few more things to tell you, I can bring them out even in response to questions from all of you. So could I turn this over to you all and see if you'd like to ask me any questions. Do give your name, what your business is when you do ask. Yes, please. And do tell me your name, what business you're in.
Leo De Souza.
Okay.
Yeah. And I have only one question. I've been listening to you intently with all ears. You never spoke about innovation. What is your take on that?
Sure. Okay. Mind you, I haven't spoken for very long, so it's not that I've covered the entire spectrum of things. And if you really look at it, I've actually begun by telling you how technology is changing and how technology is making new business models available and new things possible. All of that is innovation. Your Uber example is, for that matter, innovation. So how do you change the name of the game by continuously innovating? But again, as I said, it's always great to be able to use questions to illustrate additional points. And one of the things that I talk to you about is differentiation, and differentiation is all about innovation. Innovation doesn't have to be a new research product. It can be new business models, new approaches towards solving a customer's problem, and so on. And one of the important things you've got to remember in any business, if you ask me, is that if you enter into a business with a view to disrupting some existing business incumbent, if you don't keep innovating, then you will become the disruptee. I don't think you find that word disruptee in the dictionary. I'm not sure why it isn't there, but that's what really happens. You disrupt somebody, but if you don't keep up to date, if you don't keep innovating, if you don't have new differentiators, and remember that the life cycle of every differentiator is limited, barring one, and I'll come to that just now. If you therefore don't do that, somebody else is going to start copying and modifying or adapting your idea. You've run out of the value of that differentiator, so you must continuously innovate. And if you don't, I think then you're again in this day and age with so much rapid change, then you're going to find a business model which has become obsolete. I told you there's one differentiator which I believe that nobody can replicate, and that's your unique culture that you create. And that, to my mind, is equally a very important part of creating and starting a vibrant, healthy business. But I won't get into the details on that because I could write another. I mean, there is a chapter in the book, Mission, Vision, Values, and Building an Organizational Culture. But, it's such an important area that you could really write another whole book about it.
I am Radhakrishna. I worked for Mindtree during 2001, 2003.
Yeah, I'm delighted to hear that.
For Franklin Templeton Investments. Okay. So that's my association with your company, the old company. So my question here is, I was always attempting to do completely change the rules.
Yeah.
Okay, so lately we formed a 50-member blockchain team in Dubai, and where we are trying to take all the old rules onto the blockchain. Okay, so now my question here is, completely change the rules and first mover. When I change the rules, I need to move first. So how does that work?
Yeah, actually, to my mind, I think it's really dramatic and remarkable how much work seems to be going on blockchain. We've got a gentleman here who's got a startup which is funded by Stanford, did you say? In. Okay. Anyway, but you're really in the blockchain area, and you're developing apps and interfaces for that. You've got a team of 50. That's huge. I think there are very few people in India who have a team of that. But that doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to be the first. I think you've got to be clear. You're following on a groundswell. Now, you may be the first with a given application, by all means, or a given area or a new API or whatever it is that you develop. But it's the base technology has gathered so much momentum, so many new applications are being discovered, or invented, if you will, or innovated upon, that there's no end to the market as far as that is concerned. But I think the fact that it could do all of this got proven by virtue of the momentum that the technology has acquired, well beyond its initial startups. So there's no contradiction between saying being a first mover or an early follower here. By and large, you're an early follower in a broader movement, but within that, you are seeking to be a first mover for a given application. That's fine.
My name is Meher. I have a question for you. Since you are the author of this book, Entreprenuership Simplified, can you define in three words what is the USP of this book? And when so many other books are written on entrepreneurship, how is it so different?
Sure.
Thank
you. So let me tell you, firstly, I think the difference is literally in the subtitle, which is from idea to IPO. So it gives you the whole flow. And therefore, all the basics that are involved in starting and creating a successful enterprise. Now, since you asked me three words, I would leave it at that. But let me then add a little bit more, which is there in the preface, that in each of these areas, it tells you what and what not, why and why not, the why is important, when and where not, and timing is absolutely key in every aspect of creating a business. The time to enter the market, time to scale up, time to do your strategic sale, time to do your IPO, whatever is your goal. And then there's a why and why not also. So all of these are answered. I must give you another question, which is a delightful question I got at Sharjah yesterday, from a young kid. And maybe he looked very young, he might not have been that young. So let's say he was in early year, first year of college. And he said, why should I read your book rather than a Warren Buffett book? So I said, okay, now you've got me flummoxed here. But let me tell you that there are horses for courses. There are also books for different types of requirements. And if you're seeking to be one of the biggest and most successful investors in the world, because for all of his success, Berkshire Hathaway is in an investment company. And he's built this huge portfolio through that process. And then you can't get a better person to follow and get the advice from than Warren Buffett. If you're seeking to create an enterprise, and you're like many young entrepreneurs or potential entrepreneurs who want to create a successful enterprise, then I would say that I would certainly recommend Entrepreneurship Simplified.
Thank you. My name is James Matthew. I'm a board member. I'm a chartered accountant. You said the Uber and all this technology, they are going to be a game changer. Just wanted to ask you, today there are driverless cars going to come into the market. There are millions of job losses for the drivers. That's one side. Second side is that automobile industry will lose out on the business. Third, you will find healthcare industry, because they depend hugely on organ transplantation. And there are no accidents and there are no organ transplantation. And insurance company, there are lower risk on it. So there are not insurance is going to lose on the business. So actually, how is the economy going to progress on?
Sure. So, you know, with all of the automation, there are always a bright side and a gloomy side in the short run. And they're the optimist and the pessimist, depends on where you are. The world is adapted to all this change, if you ask me in the past. Look at what happened with the Industrial Revolution. Everybody said, now nobody's going to have jobs because you're automating so many things which were not automated at that time. Of course, the pace of change is much higher now, and the ranges of technology are much higher. Within your statement, there were some things which maybe one would not agree with. But that doesn't change the fundamental plank. The plank you're making is that, yes, a lot of jobs are going to get lost, a lot of industries will get impacted, perhaps. But see, this vehicle ownership may not go down at all. It may actually increase with the driverless cars. So you've got, and it's not that people are not going to have the ability to drive. They'll want to do it, but they'll do it on an exceptional basis or don't need to do it all the time in a long journey. I've never driven in an so-called automated car until my last trip to the US, where I found that one of my colleagues decided to reward himself with that for having delivered, got a huge order and therefore a large business. So he went and ordered and got a Tesla. I found it a little unnerving to think that he doesn't have his hand on a wheel, and every now and then it seems to adjust itself because it works on the principle of being in the middle of the lane. So if anything happens where the road curves, it will adjust itself. But if you have a huge vehicle next to you, which is a big, large truck, you feel a little nervous. You wouldn't want to be in the center of the lane. You'd like to be on the left-hand side. But it doesn't do that. That can make you nervous. But leaving that aside, the fact is that car ownership won't go down. I think it will still increase. The type of cars will change. Big concern to this region is obviously that petroleum and fuels for cars are certainly undergoing a huge decline in demand, apart from the fact there are multiple new sources which never existed in the world. So that industry is going to change. The types of changes you talked about in insurance premiums, etc., assuming they do go down, they'll only enlarge the market. That's been the experience of every industry. You become more competitive, costs go down, more people are able to afford, markets grow. So I don't see that as a gloom issue. But on the biggest thing that is happening all around in terms of automation and AI in particular, where people are saying that, you know, X percentage of the jobs will disappear and you'll never be able to replace them. Or that human, the robots will take over the world and so on. Stephen Hawking is of that view. He really is a pessimist in terms of the fact you've got to control it before they go and take charge. And on the other hand, someone like Bill Gates has the response I gave you, that look, the world will find a solution, it always has.
Thank you, sir, for this wonderful and insightful talk on various aspects of entrepreneurship. And especially great to know how a lot of strategies, concepts are still derived from age-old combat techniques too. Great. May I request our president, Mrs. Bindu Chatur, to present a memento to Mr. Ashok. Now may I request Mr. Janak Panjwani, our treasurer, to introduce our next speaker.
Monis Rahman, currently a head of research at Mobius and Stanford University blockchain startup. He has been a Bitcoin blockchain enthusiast since 2013 when he bought a Bitcoins at sub 100 USD prices. Before dropping out to join Mobius, Mohsin was doing his PhD in computational and mathematical engineering at Stanford University. Monis has also consulted with Government of India and major institutional banks to design auction-based solution for stressed assets. Mobius is a blockchain startup which seeks to easily connect computer programs and everyday devices to blockchain ecosystem. Mobius is partnering with various financial institutions to make a cross-border payment using a blockchain technology a reality, including a Rack Bank in the MENA region and ICICI Bank in India. Please put your hands together to welcome Monis Rahman.
Hi everyone, it's a pleasure being here and addressing this gathering. So how many of you guys own Bitcoins? Just one? So you must be curious what Bitcoin owners are. So this was my introduction. Essentially, I bought Bitcoins a long time ago and my friends thought that I was playing roulette or gambling of some sort. My mom thought I was doing some science fiction stuff, while society, I think, thinks that we are playing with fake money. The government was actually thinking that we are doing something illegal, money laundering, in fact. And I actually thought that I was just making a killing on the stock market or becoming really successful. But what I realized that what we are actually doing is just buying and sleeping on our Bitcoins. So, yeah. So do you want to become a Bitcoin owner is actually one of the questions that generally gets asked. And if you see in the past 1 year, the price has gone up almost 7,000 from this was yesterday, and it's gone up from about $1,000 at the start of the year to about 7,000, so it's 700 times up. The market cap hit $120 billion recently, and you have, yeah, so these are some of the stats. So first part of this presentation, I'm going to discuss some myths about Bitcoin so that you have a better idea of what the rumors are and what the reality is. So the first rumor is that, is it a bubble? essentially, this is I bought Bitcoins for my cousin sister, and she's made a huge killing off it. But every time the price dips by 10%, she's like, should I sell? So that's a personal choice, by the way. I'm going long on Bitcoin for another 2 years at least. So yeah. So the first myth was, what do you use Bitcoin for? Initially, it was used for, people were using it to buy drugs online. So right now, there are a lot of billion-dollar companies which are accepting Bitcoin. Microsoft is definitely one of them. PayPal has actually even backed us unofficially. So what are the advantages to using Bitcoin? And the primary use of Bitcoin is transferring money around. And you know, if you go to Western Union, they charge you $5 for a transfer fee, for example. And you can use Bitcoin, and it's really, the transaction costs are very, very low. In fact, if you use other networks, the transaction costs are in fact free. This was Shah Rukh Khan sending money anywhere to any bank in India, well, selected banks. But then you can have Bitcoin and you can send money anywhere without any banks in the loop. Is Bitcoin illegal? So we have had regulators all over the world come out and issue warnings. Abu Dhabi, the regulation is not very clear, but they have, they've hired the person, they're working with the Japanese regulator, and so the regulations are very similar to Japan, and Japan is one of the countries which is actually pretty legal on ICOs. So if you see, about 50 plus countries have Bitcoin completely legal, and the yellow ones are where it's contentious and also getting legal. Even Russia, Russia and India are definitely coming on board. China is a bit of an issue. Next major question that we get asked is it a Ponzi scheme? If you see, in a Ponzi scheme, usually there is exponential growth. Over here, what is happening is by 2021, the number of Bitcoins is going to, there'll be 21 million Bitcoins by 2021. And then the number of new Bitcoins getting minted or created is going to just stop. And so it's in fact the opposite of a Ponzi scheme. The thing, people obviously have this idea that Bitcoin is like digital gold, so actually it's a currency. And you had Tyler Winklevoss, were part of the Winklevoss twins, who conceived the idea of Facebook before Mark Zuckerberg implemented it. And they're calling it a currency which is based on money. And they're actually pretty long on Bitcoin. I think they own like $500 million worth of Bitcoin right now. The others are, he's a technology innovator from the Bay Area. And so usually you had currencies which were originally based on commodities like gold. Then you had government-backed currencies that we have today like dirhams or dollars. And now you have a new currency based on math. And we'll get more into details later, but so Bitcoin is actually not digital gold, it's just another currency. In fact, it's downloadable money. So, we'll have printing 3D printers eventually, and you can print your own car, but right now you can download your own money. The most important property about Bitcoin that sets it apart from other currencies is that it's more like a bearer instrument. If you actually hold possession, even if you've stolen it, you are the owner, essentially. People can't reclaim it back from you. So that's an important property to keep in mind. And security, therefore, is a big, important thing. So Bitcoin is actually very, very easy to use. It is exactly like email. You have an address, you have a password, and you transfer your email messages through the internet, you transfer Bitcoins through the internet. So the public key, which is a bunch of numbers and alphabets, is your address. It's like your email address, and your private key, which is what you need to keep really safe, is the password. And these are automatically generated in a Bitcoin wallet. You look at that, yeah. So the security issue comes in.
and a lot of people have gotten Bitcoin stolen. My Bitcoin was stolen when Mt. Gox went down. There was in late 2014. The way to actually keep Bitcoin secure is to, like, you know, you actually just buy an extra laptop, store it on it, and never connect it again to the internet. And you can do all your transfers through a USB drive. So that's called air gapping. One more important thing is Bitcoin anonymous? The thing is the public keys or public addresses are publicly known, and you can see all the transactions on them. So it's really not, it's not anonymous. It's less private. It's completely not private. Everything is done on a public ledger, a public accounting system. But the person behind the account is not known. You know what account was used, but you don't know who owns the account. So there are other cryptocurrencies, which are like Zcash, Monero, and Dash, which are actually designed to be completely anonymous. On the other hand, Bitcoin is not anonymous. You will get caught if you're doing something wrong. So it's actually called pseudonymous. So a little background about me is that I was doing my PhD at Stanford in computational math, and I was doing a dual major. So the second major was in market design. Market design, we were talking about organ transplantation. So my advisor designed the organ swap system in the United States. And so I'm going to take a market design based perspective on explaining what blockchain is. Blockchain is the underlying technology and how we can go about developing our own Bitcoin based system. So let's start with playing a game, essentially. We can call it Monopoly. And the game has tradable assets. Monopoly, you have houses and hotels. And to trade those assets, you actually need a currency. Now, we call our currency tokens, for example. So we want to avoid paper bills because it becomes confusing and people are counterfeiting and making fake bills. So what we do is we start an accounting system. In India, long ago, we used to have, people used to keep accounts in their khatas. The game is played by a number of players, and we have an accounting system. Whatever the accounting system, we have four players actually. Yeah, so whatever the accounting system says accordingly, that's how much money each person has. For example, there are four players, and each of them is given 100 tokens at the start of the game. And so that's your account in the bottom, that everyone's name is listed, which is your account, and how much balance is there in each account. So this ledger, this accounting system is law, and whatever is written over there decides how much money each player has. Mm-hmm. So now in our ledger, everyone has 100 tokens. So you can see I've given 100 tokens to everyone effectively. The problem comes in that, whoever is in charge of the ledger will start cheating. They'll start, changing, increasing their own balance, reducing everyone else's balance, and we don't want that to happen. So what we do, so that's called accounting fraud, essentially. What we do is we give every player one copy of the ledger. So everyone has their own ledger, which has all the accounts on it, and accordingly, everyone gets how much money they have is based on what's the balance in their account. And anytime there's any trade or any changes, then all the ledgers have to be updated. So for example, I sell, Monis sells to Monopoly Hotel to Rupesh for 20 tokens. So what Monis will do then is update his accounts, and then he'll go to every other player and get them to update their account. So that's what I've done now. So you can see the update is there. Now I have 120 tokens, Rupesh goes to 80 tokens. And the game continues. The way to stop people from lying and just making fake transactions, we require that the ledger needs to be signed. So essentially, any other player updates their accounts when they see that my account was signed by the transactor. Yep. So these are updated and with signs. So now the question is, what happens if we want a very large number of people playing our game, maybe situated all over the world. You can't just physically do this every time. So what we do is we replace the ledger or the bahi khata with a digital version of it. And we have fancy software which syncs all the ledgers. So essentially, I make a transaction on my system and on my set of the ledger, and that syncs with all the ledgers on the world. And these are all independently maintained. So we have actually developed a new payment currency system, and it's a distributed ledger. So in a distributed public ledger, in fact. And the accounts, instead of the name, you have the public key or the address, and the private key is to sign off. So whenever you do a transaction, you need your private key to sign, and this is all encrypted, so it stays safe. Effectively, no one actually controls the system anymore, and there is no middleman, so there is no middleman fees. There are different ways to incentivize the, and there's no government shutdown. So even if some of the accountants or nodes in the public ledger are taken away, the remaining will stay there and the system will keep continuing. So we can call this Bitcoin, or we can call it any IBBVC coin, or whatever you prefer. Each of the separate nodes are actually called miners in Bitcoin terminology. And this is what a miner looks like. And most people, they actually get paid with newly minted Bitcoins to do the work they're performing, which is syncing the ledger. This is what it looks in reality, actually. These things consume a lot of electricity. And you can see this is a little outdated, but about $150,000 worth of electricity is spent just running the system every day. Newer blockchains actually don't consume that much energy. And so the important thing was that Bitcoin is a digital currency, and a lot of people think it's a bubble, but it's not Bitcoin what's important. What's important is the underlying distributed ledger technology, which we call blockchain. First thing I'll discuss is why do we call it blockchain? And that is, you have all these individual transactions. What happens is after a certain number of transactions are done, usually based on time, 10 minutes for Bitcoin, every 10 minutes they take all the transactions that are done and they encrypt it. And that's called a block. Every 10 minutes there's a new block essentially formed. And then they string all the blocks together. That's why it's called blockchain. So Bitcoin was the first blockchain that was created, and the use case on that blockchain was the Bitcoin cryptocurrency. Since then, we have had a large number of new blockchains. Essentially, Ethereum was the second one which got very famous, and it's the second largest, in fact. There was also Ripple, which is focused on sending out remittances, and Stellar. Cryptocurrency is the main use case right now, but other use cases include healthcare records and public land records, real estate transactions essentially. The Dubai government, in fact, is getting on all the real estate transactions in Dubai will be on a public blockchain ledger. So these are some of the countries which are, so Dubai is there. Andhra Pradesh is also doing the same thing. They're putting all the real estate transactions on the blockchain. Estcoin was, Estonia has come up, was the first country to come up with its own cryptocurrency. I put an IBM over here because we are actually working with IBM to make cross-border banking solutions possible. So if you want to transfer money abroad in the future, you don't have to go to a bank. You can just transact through us. A lot of times what happens is if you're a trader and you're blacklisted at one bank and there's another bank, your customer is blacklisted in another bank, it becomes difficult to transact. So people have actually started doing this, that they'll just transfer money using Bitcoins or other cryptocurrencies. In fact, on the Stellar network, you don't even have to use a cryptocurrency. You can directly transact in dirhams or dollars, and hopefully soon, very soon, rupees also. So this was the announcement that was there recently. Anyways, another last important topic that I want to touch upon is what's an ICO. So an ICO is a new form of crowd fundraising. So there have been a lot of ICOs in the past year. I would say they've raised about $2.5 billion. And so ICOs, if you support a company, you can just go and buy a crypto token that that company is selling. Before the ICO, you get a bonus. Post ICO, the price, then they get listed on exchanges and the price starts fluctuating based on trading. The way to evaluate an ICO is important. It's essentially, these are all new companies, they're startups, and they're skipping a few steps and going, starting crowdfunding, not going to VCs. So you should just go and look at what their track record is, what work they have done in the past. What's another important thing is you should read their white paper, which is a technical descriptor of what they're doing. Look at their team, if they have news coverage and advisors. And an important thing is to look at their tax structure. Currently, ICOs are taxed at about 50% in the United States. So you don't want to give money to a company that's going to use half that money to pay off taxes. So that's all for today. So you can contact me, and Rupesh and Majid were introduced me to IBPC. And if I'm based out of San Francisco. If I'm not here, you can contact them if you have any questions, and they'll forward it to me. Yep. Thank you.
Presentation. Yeah. I wanted to understand, where do we see the Bitcoin going?
Price-wise?
Yeah.
There are people I've heard who say $1 million. There are people who say $100,000. The thing is, the United States economy has historically moved from a bubble to another bubble. So the previous bubble was the subprime mortgage bubble, which reached about $3 trillion. Bitcoin is only at about $120 billion right now. So the price should be going up for the next couple of years. That's my personal opinion, yeah.
So you think we can still invest?
Oh, this is a good time to get in, actually. Yeah, in fact, on November 18th, the blockchain is forking, so it'll split into two parts, and your account will work on both the new one and the split, and both parts of the split. So the bigger one will be Bitcoin, the smaller one will become Bitcoin Gold, and you'll get an extra currency which will be worth about $400, $500. That's why the price has recently gone up in the past 1 week. It was at about, it's gone up to 7,000 something, about $1,000 has gone up. And that's because this was being priced into the market.
Thank you. Welcome. Country where the tax structure is less?
Also, we are based in San Francisco. I'll just tell you our personal experience. And we actually shifted our company's tax structure to the Cayman Islands. In fact, we are doing our ICO next month, and or later this month, in fact, now it's November. So in the Cayman Islands, there's 0% tax.
Yeah, we also researched on Estonia.
Estonia and actually Europe, a lot of people actually do Switzerland and Estonia. There are some issues with the company regulate, it gives a lot of authority to board members which are just nominated. And makes it difficult to, there's a ICO, a company called Tezos, which is having issues in Switzerland. That's actually why we chose Cayman Islands. And Estonia is also a good option. Switzerland is the most used option, but now there are issues with Switzerland. So that's why people are looking at other destinations.
So lately I read that EST coin.
Yeah.
So Estonia is publishing that all the ICOs and cryptocurrencies can peg to the EST coin and control the fluctuation. Is it true?
So that's the plan. I don't know how it will work. Someone has to do an ICO, which has to be a fairly large company, so that we can see how it plays out in actuality. But there is another startup that I know that is coming out with a platform to control the volatility and give you a fixed growth rate. They do that to some extent on Stellar, where the circulation increases by 1% every year, but that hasn't been very successful in my opinion.
Limited number of bitcoins which are going to be mined.
Yes.
That's a certain number, yep. After which you can't do anymore. I don't quite understand this, but this is what I've read at least.
Yep.
By the sheer law of economics, if suppose the supply is going to be limited at a certain point of time, the price should keep on increasing, well, infinitely, if it is still in demand in that sense. So then, these two aspects, I'm not able to comprehend where this is, the whole thing is leading from a point of view of an investor.
Yeah, so the thing is, you're right, by 2021, the number of bitcoins, or that will be, right now there are about 16.5 million in circulation, and you'll have about 21 million by 2021. And miners are paid with the new, every time the people who are running the blockchain get paid with all the newly minted bitcoins. So as an investor, you should see that yes, the demand is outstripping supply, and that's why the price keeps going up. Other thing is, that may not always be the case, you know. People may, there may not be a lot of demand in the future, and people will start dumping their bitcoins and taking profit. Other thing, transaction wise, this doesn't make any difference, because you don't have the, Bitcoin is not in whole numbers. You can go to like a millionth Bitcoin, like you can go .0.00001 Bitcoin and use that to transact. It may be worth $100 at that point, but you'll be transacting with a very small number of Bitcoin, fractional uses there. That eventually it's your personal decision. Understanding it, Bitcoin is just a use case on the accounting system, which is the Bitcoin blockchain. And blockchain is here to stay, definitely. So you should hopefully invest in blockchain more than Bitcoin. Bitcoin more is a more like a fad, because the newer blockchains have they're better designed and they have better uses than the Bitcoin system, which is kind of a legacy system now.
Thank you, Mr. Monis, for this awareness session on Bitcoin and the blockchain technology. Now, may I request our president, Ms. Bindu Chatur, to present a moment to Mr. Monis, please. Thank you, Mr. Monis, once again. I once again thank you, all of you, to be present here today and to be a part of this wonderful dwell session. I would like to specially thank our support partners for today's event, Sharjah International Book Fair and DC Books, and as always, our platinum sponsors, Danube, NMC, UAE Exchange, Nikkei, TASE, Bank of Baroda, IFCO, and our media partners, Gulf News. All of you have a great day ahead. Thank you.